we're going to talk about inverse proportion. Now, inverse proportion is not the same thing as the proportionality you first learned about in school. When we say x and y are inversely proportional, what we mean is that the product of x and y is some constant. And that's what inverse proportion means. Now, here, x is 24 when y is 18. That constant is 24 times 18. Whatever that is. Now, we could go ahead and figure that out, but we don't have to. What we're trying to find is x when y is 90. And we know that the product of this x and 90 has to be the same thing as the first product we got when x was 24 and y was 18. That's what inverse proportion means. It means this times this equals this times this. Now, we can solve for x by dividing both sides by 90. And we get 24 times 18 over 90, take out a factor of 18, and we get x is 24 over 5. Now check this out. Y is 18, we make it go up to 90. We're multiplying y by 5. And look what happens to x. It goes from 24 down to 24 over 5. We're dividing x by 5. We multiplied y by 5, we divided x by 5. And that makes sense when we look back at this equation. We want x, y to stay constant. So if we multiply y by 5, we need to divide x by 5 to keep this product constant. So we can think about inverse proportionality with scaling, just like we did with direct proportion. We scale y up by some factor, we have to scale x down by that factor to keep this product constant. You double y, you have to have x. You triple y, you divide x by 3. Same thing if we go the other way. If you have y, you have to double x, and so on. We can also see this by dividing both sides here by y. And x is some constant divided by y. Now, if we multiply y by 5, look what happens to the right-hand side. We're dividing the right-hand side by 5. We're dividing x by 5. So now that we understand the basics of inverse proportion, let's put it to work on a work problem. Now, we at Art of Problem Solving, we run a national math competition called the USA Mathematical Talent Search. I got one of their t-shirts on right now. And what we do here is we send out math problems all over the country, and students send us back solutions, and we have to grade them. We get so many solutions, it takes a long time to grade them. Now, I figure the most recent batch, it's going to take 30 hours for our 8 graders to grade them all. I'd like to sleep. So I want to cut this down to 12 hours. How are we going to do that? How many graders do we need? I have to think about how the number of graders and the time are related. If I double the number of graders, well, that should halve the amount of work we each have to do. That'll halve the amount of time. If we triple the graders, we'll divide the amount of work by 3 and so on. The time and the number of graders, they're inversely proportional. So the time times the number of graders, that's a constant. And that makes sense. This time times the number of graders, that's the total number of hours across everybody. If you take all the time everybody spends grading and add it all up, that's what we have right here. And that's a constant. All that that depends on is the number of papers we have. Now, if we increase the number of graders we get, then we divide that work among more people. It'll take us less time to finish. So we have this nice inverse proportionality here. And we can go ahead and set up and solve this problem. We know that this constant is 30 times 8. So if I want to cut that time down to 12, I'll let the number of graders we need be g. We have this equation. Divide both sides by 12. We get 30 times 8 over 12. 8 divided by 12 is 2/3. 2/3 of 30 is 20. And we also could have solved this problem by thinking about scaling. We want to scale 30 hours down to 12 hours. So to get from 30 down to 12, we multiply by 12 over 30, which is 2/5. So to scale from 30 down to 12, we multiply by 2/5. That means the graders, we need to multiply that by the reciprocal of 2/5. If we scale down by a factor of 2/5, we need to take the graders up by a factor of 5/2. Because 2/5 times 5/2 is 1. So we need to take our graders and multiply that by 5/2. 8 divided by 2 is 4. 5 times 4 is 20. We've solved the same problem two different ways. We got the same answer both times. We know we're right. Now let's take this inverse proportion and put it together with the direct proportion that we learned about earlier. We can do that in electricity. Now, Ohm's law tells us that the current and resistance are inversely proportional. And the resistance of a wire is directly proportional to the wire's length. Now suppose I have a circuit. The only thing I can change on that circuit is the length of a wire on there. And I want to double the current for some reason. I want to double the current. What do I need to do to the length of that wire? Do I need to double it? Halve it? Multiply it by 4? Divide it by 4? Let's think about this a little bit. We want to figure out how the current and the length are related, because the only thing I can change is the length, and I want to change the current. I know how the length and the resistance are related. They're directly proportional. I take the length up, the resistance goes up. Well, I know how the resistance and the current are related. They're inversely proportional. Resistance goes up, current goes down. So length goes up, resistance goes up. Resistance goes up, current goes down. Looks like length up, current down. It looks like they're inversely proportional. Now let's see if we can take our definition of direct proportionality and inverse proportionality and prove that the length and the current are inversely proportional. Now we're going to need some variables. We'll start with I for current. And when you get to an electrical engineering class, you'll figure out why we use I for that. R is resistance. And L will be our length. So we know that the length and the resistance are directly proportional. The current and resistance are inversely proportional. We'll start with that. Current and resistance are inversely proportional. So I times R equals some constant. Now I'm going to use the variable K, and I'm going to put a subscript on that because we're going to need a second constant. That's our first constant, K1. We're going to need another constant for the fact that the resistance and the length are directly proportional. That tells us that the ratio of the resistance and the length is some other constant. That's what direct proportionality means. Now I want to put I and L together. I want to get rid of R because I want to see how I and L are related. I can do that. I can solve this equation for R, multiply both sides by L, and substitute this back in over here. I get I times K2L equals K1. Now I'm going to divide both sides here by K2 because I just want to see what happens when I and L are together. And we have I times L is K1 over K2. These are both constants, so their ratio, when we divide one by the other, we get some other constant. And that tells me that the current and the length, their product is constant, which means they're inversely proportional. So if I want to double the current, I have to halve the length of the wire. Thank you.